I was lost, totally lost. I was 17 and parents divorced. My mom remarried, I have kids. My dad remarried, I have kids. And I'm the only child of something who never works. And then they cut your passion.
Luc Besson. He is France's most commercially successful filmmaker, and there is nobody that makes movies quite like him. Films like La Femme Nikita, The Professional, Lucy, and of course the cult classic The Fifth Element. But none of this was the plan. He was born to scuba instructor parents, and as a kid what he wanted to be was a marine biologist. Instead, he's now delivered the most expensive film ever made in France, Valerian and the City of a Thousand Planets. It is a sprawling epic, but the origins of the movie can be traced all the way back to a very sad 10-year-old boy named Luc suffering through his parents' bitter divorce.
I was living on the countryside, far from Paris, one black and white TV channel, that's it. Yeah. My stepfather doesn't like music and arts and things, so it was pretty dry at home. And then every Wednesday there is this little comic book, and inside there is two pages of Valerian and Laureline, two agents traveling through space and time. It was just like an open gate for everything for me. So I have to wait 6 days to get two new pages. And I was imagining it for 6 days, you know, like, oh my God, what's gonna happen and things. So it brings me a lot of things at the time.
You're a fairly creative kid. What was it like suddenly being in a house where there was no music and no TV? That must have been a bit difficult.
That's the strange thing. It's your brain is compensating because you can't have it, so you're creating it. So suddenly I take a rock and then I can play with my rock, and it's cowboys and Indians, and 5 minutes later it's a spaceship. So your imagination is compensating what you don't have. I was lucky, in fact, to get nothing when I was young.
That's a good way of thinking about it. I never thought about it in those terms.
3, 2, 1, exit.
Action!
Do you get nervous watching a movie with an audience?
Yeah, a little bit. I go sometime in the audience, and the audience are so different. I give you one example. It's like Joan of Arc, there is this scene where suddenly there's this machine. And then suddenly the head of the guy whopped out. And I watched the film in America. The audience is overreacting. Oh my God, oh my God, oh, it's so bloody, oh my God, like this. And you're like, whoa, it's working. And then a few weeks later, I'm in Japan.
Yeah, right.
And the Japanese are watching the film like this, and then suddenly, oh, so desu ka. Oh, so desu ka. It's cool.
This year, The Fifth Element turns 20. It's one of those incredible cult movies that is beloved, like people adore it. But when it came out, you went to a cinema in Middle America. What sort of experience did you have when you saw Middle America reacting to The Fifth Element?
All the films I've done never have a good reaction in America. None of my film works in America.
Why do you think that is?
Because it's not about the power of America. It's something different. And they can't accept it. They're very self-centered. You know, like 30% of Americans have a passport. It says a lot.
Oh, Father, you're so wrong.
It's about their power and their control, and they want to have a good image of themselves. You know, you can't make in America a film where the Indians are the good guys and the cowboys are the bad guys.
Even now, after all these years?
Even now, do it, it's not gonna work, for sure. They can't see it, they can't accept that, it's impossible. It's not in their mentality. And I'm not judging them, it's just a fact.
You're going to have to learn to develop those communication skills.
I don't want to do the big Hollywood, Marvel, DC Comics, who are here as a propaganda for America to show how powerful they are and how they can save the world. And I want to propose something different, not in opposition, just different. The richness is the diversity.
You see, Father, by creating a little destruction,
hey, Jerry,
I'm in fact encouraging life.
Can I ask you a little bit about your time as a kid? Because initially, before film entered the picture, you wanted to study dolphins, didn't you?
Yeah.
And then you had an accident. Do you remember what went through your head when you realised that you weren't going to be able to do the diving career that you wanted?
I was lost, totally lost. I was 17 and my passion get stopped right there. So almost suicidal.
Wow.
Yeah, because you don't see the future at all. You don't see anything. And I was, you know, my parents divorced. My mom remarried. I have kids. My dad remarried. I have kids. And I'm the only child of something who never works. And then they cut your passion. And then you're born in school.
Yeah, right.
I was near the cliff. Like you feel that you can, you know, go in the hole. And then I was lucky enough that one day, a little bit by hazard, I went to a set.
Fred was making a short film.
Of a short film, and I fall in love. The sets was full of lights and costume. And when I arrived, I was 17, and the girl came and say, "Oh, you're here to help?" And I say, "Yeah, what's your name?" "Luke." "Okay, can you do this and this?" And I was amazed that no one is asking me anything except like, "Are you here for the film? Are you friend with the film?" "Yeah, okay, here, do that." And for me, it was such a relief that I was finally taken from who I am or who I could be.
You used to sleep on set, I read, is that true?
Yep, because I don't know where to sleep anyway. I was living at 60 kilometers from Paris, so I always say, you know, I can stay and I can keep an eye on the material.
You offered to be the security guard.
Yeah.
That's ingenuity right there.
And then every night I was like opening every box just to understand what's in it, the lens, the thing.
If you could go back and talk to Luc at the age of 16, just at that moment, when he finds out he can't swim with dolphins anymore, that very dark moment, what would you tell him about his future?
I'm amazed every day to see where I am, in fact, every day. Every day I wake up and I'm like, I don't know how I managed to go through all these things. I was probably stubborn, for sure.
Last shot of the film!
If you have a dream, try until the end, because it doesn't matter if you succeed or not, but you sleep way much better by trying. Just before to start my first film, I remember praying the sky and say, "Please let me do one. I swear, as soon as I did one, I won't complain anymore, but let me do one film." When I finished the first one, I said, "Can I do just two, okay? Just two," and then I stop after that. I stop complaining. So I'm still amazed that I'm able to do this all these films, and I'm so lucky.
Luc, thank you so much for talking to us. Really enjoyed talking to you. Thank you so much.